Hello, this is day 99 of reading one canto of the Divine Comedy every day. We are on Paradiso Canto 32, which I'll read from the Longfellow translation before giving some quick comments. Absorbed in his delight, that contemplator assumed the willing office of a teacher and gave beginning to these holy words. The wound that Mary closed up and anointed, she at her feet, who is so beautiful, she is the one who opened it and pierced it. Within that order which the third seats make is seated Rachel, lower than the other, with Beatrice in manner as thou seest, Sarah, Rebecca, Judith, and her who was ancestress of the singer, who for dole of the misdeed said, Miserere mei. Canst thou behold from seat to seat descending down in gradation, as with each one's name I through the rows go down from leaf to leaf? And downward, from the seventh row, even as above the same, succeed the Hebrew women, dividing all the tresses of the flower. Because, according to the view which faith in Christ had taken, these are the partition by which the sacred stairways are divided. Upon this side, where perfect is the flower with each one of its petals, seated are those who believed in Christ who was to come. Upon the other side, where intersected with vacant spaces are the semicircles, are those who looked to Christ already come. And as, upon this side, the glorious seat of the Lady of Heaven, and the other seats below it, such a great division make, so opposite doth that of the great John, who, ever holy, desert and martyrdom endured, and afterwards 2 years in hell. And under him thus to divide were chosen Francis, and Benedict, and Augustine, and down to us the rest from round to round. Behold now the high providence divine, for one and other aspect of the faith in equal measure shall this garden fill. And know that downward from that rank which cleaves midway the sequence of the two divisions, not by their proper merit are they seated, but by another's under fixed conditions. For these are spirits one and all assoiled before they any true election had. Well canst thou recognize it in their faces, and also in their voices puerile, if thou regard them well and hearken to them. Now doubtest thou, and doubting thou art silent, but I will loosen for thee the strong bond in which thy subtle fancies hold thee fast. Within the amplitude of this domain, no casual point can possibly find place, no more than sadness can, or thirst, or hunger. For by eternal law has been established whatever thou beholdest, so that closely the ring is fitted to the finger here. And therefore are these people, festinate unto true life, not sine causa here, more and less excellent among themselves, the king, by means of whom this realm reposes in so great love, and in so great delight that no will ventureth to ask for more, in his own joyous aspect every mind creating, at his pleasure dowers with grace diversely, and let here the effect suffice. And this is clearly and expressly noted for you in Holy Scripture, in those twins who in their mother had their anger roused. According to the color of the hair, therefore, with such a grace the light supreme consenteth that they worthily be crowned. Without, then, any merit of their deeds, stationed are they in different gradations, differing only in their first acuteness. 'Tis true that in the early centuries, with innocence to work out their salvation, sufficient was the faith of parents only. After the earlier ages were completed, behoved it that the males by circumcision unto their innocent wings should virtue add. But after that, the time of grace had come without the baptism absolute of Christ. Such innocence below there was retained. Look now into the face that unto Christ hath most resemblance, for its brightness only is able to prepare thee to see Christ. On her did I behold so great a gladness rain down, borne outward in the holy minds created through that altitude to fly, that whatsoever I had seen before did not suspend me in such admiration, nor show me such similitude of God. And the same love that first descended there, Ave Maria, gratia plena, singing, in front of her his wings expanded wide. Unto the canticle divine responded from every part the court beatified, so that each sight became serener for it. O Holy Father, who for me endurest to be below here, leaving the sweet place in which thou sittest by eternal lot, who is the angel that with so much joy into the eyes is looking of our Queen, enamored so that he seems made of fire? Thus I again recourse had to the teaching of that one who delighted him in Mary as doth the star of morning in the sun. And he to me, such gallantry and grace as there can be in angel and in soul, all is in him. and thus we fain would have it, because he is the one who bore the palm down unto Mary, when the Son of God to take our burden on himself decreed. But now, come onward with thine eyes, as I speaking shall go, and note the great patricians of this most just and merciful of empires. Those two that sit above there, most in rapture, as being very near unto Augusta, are, as it were, the two roots of this rose. He who upon the left is near her placed, the Father is, by whose audacious taste the human species so much bitter tastes. Upon the right thou seest that ancient father of Holy Church, into whose keeping Christ the keys committed of this lovely flower. And he who all the evil days beheld, before his death, of her the beauteous bride, who with the spear and with the nails was won, beside him sits. And by the other rests that leader, under whom on manna lived the people ingrate, fickle, and stiff-necked. Opposite Peter seest thou Anna seated, so well content to look upon her daughter. Her eyes she moves not while she sings Hosanna. And opposite the eldest household father, Lucia, sits, she who thy lady moved when to rush downward thou didst bend thy brows. But since the moments of thy vision fly, here will we make full stop, as a good tailor who makes the gown according to his cloth. And unto the first love we'll turn our eyes, that looking upon him thou penetrate as far as possible through his effulgence. Truly, lest peradventure thou recede, moving thy wings, believing to advance, by prayer behoves it that grace be obtained. Grace from that one who has the power to aid thee, and thou shalt follow me with thy affection, that from my words thy heart turn not aside. And he began this holy orison. I had mentioned before how we ought to be on the lookout for the three stages of the medieval spiritual life: purgation, illumination, and perfection. Last time in Canto 31, we definitely had something of a purgation. Bernard asked Dante to raise his eyes higher. And then what happens in Canto 32? We have illumination. He explains to him everything that he's seeing in great detail, makes sure that he can understand it. He illumines his mind. The rose is split basically down the middle, such that there are, on one side, all the souls that came before Christ, and on the other, those who came after Christ, but both accept and believe. Bernard even says that there's an equal number of seats on both sides. Very interesting. And this is something that Dante pointed out a few cantos ago as well, that there aren't very many seats left. Is heaven actually going to run out of room? No. Is that kind of determinism shining through? Maybe a little bit. But the message to the Florentians, let's say, is clear. Clean up your act. We see several souls here who we've met already, like Benedict, St. Peter, Adam, they're all here, as well as the others that we've maybe been looking for or have heard about, but haven't seen until now. Eve, many of the other women from the Bible, St. Francis, Moses. And Bernard also shows him some children who were not of the age of reason, not really able to choose God for themselves. Dante's confused then. If they weren't really old enough to make any great moral choices themselves, then why are they arranged in a certain way, with some higher and some lower? Bernard explains to him two things. Number one, nobody is where they are by chance. God has chosen where each person is going to sit, and it is by their merits that they receive grace from God, freely offered. However, as seen in the tale of Jacob and Esau, sometimes God can show favor onto just whom he loves, just because, even if they don't have any merits at all. In that case, it's simply up to God's pleasure, which is the case for all of the seats that we see. There's no jealousy here, no malassigned seating. Everybody's in exactly the right spot. Mark Musa explains that the two roots of the rose that are close to the top are St. Peter and Adam, because from Adam came all of the one half of the rose, those who came before Christ, and then from St. Peter come all of the other half of the rose, that is, the church. He was the first leader of the church who Christ appointed. St. Lucy is also visible, who was the one who sent Beatrice to help Dante. Bernard stops his oration and explains to Dante that it is now time for him to look upon God himself. But he can't try to penetrate into his depths and try to understand him by his own power. Despite all of the impediments to his sight that have been taken away, now it's not important for him to try to do anything, but instead ask to be given the vision that he needs. What is perceived will not be by his own power, even though his soul has been improving steadily throughout the Paradiso. No, whatever is seen will simply be gift from God. And so Bernard says, pray to Mary that she will grant the grace that you are able to do so. The canto ends just before Bernard begins his prayer, which Dante is meant to be following along with. In canto 33, then, we are expecting there will be the stage of perfection, when Dante finally looks upon God and experiences, just for a moment, full communion with him. That's all for today, though. I'll see you tomorrow.